الرحمن الرحيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله بارئ الخلائق الأجمعين بائت الأنبياء والمرسلين ثم الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء حبيب قلوبنا وشفيع ذنوبنا أبي القاسم محمد
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد
والصلاة والسلام على أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين صلى الله عليك يا مولاي يا أبا عبد الله صلى الله عليك يا مولاي يا أبا عبد الله يا رحمة الله الواسعة ويا باب نجاة الأمة يا غريب الغرباء يا مذموم كربلاء السلام على من جعل الله الشفاء في تربته السلام على من الإجابة تحت كبته السلام على ساكن كربلاء فيا ليتنا ثم يا ليتنا كنا معكم سادتي يا سادتي فنفوز فوزا عظيما
اللهم صل على
محمد وآل محمد
قال مولانا إمام جعفر بن محمد وهو أصدق الصادقين صلوات الله وسلامه عليه
اللهم صل على
محمد
وآل محمد
من ذكر الحسين عنده وبكى أو تباكى فله الجنة صدق الإمام وآمنا به زين مجالسكم بذكر محمد وآل محمد
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد
Our sixth Imam, in one of his traditions in regards to commemorating the musibah of Sayyid al-Shuhada, says, for a person who remembers the masa'ib of Imam, or if the Imam is remembered in his presence, if this person cries or pretends to cry, then for him there is Jannah. Ajeeb. Imam al-Sadiq says, when we look at the word tabaki, yani if you are sitting in a majma' and Sayyid al-Shuhada's masa'ib is being remembered, the mercy of Sayyid al-Shuhada is so great that if a person sits in that majlis and his heart is sad, but his tears doesn't come out even because of his sadness and the way he portrays his grief, then because of the adama of Sayyid al-Shuhada for that person, that is even more. Ajeeb, the mercy of Sayyid al-Shuhada. When Rasulullah said, Husayn minni wa ana min al-Husayn, This hadith is carried in the form of a literal way, hakiki, and is even carried from the way of majazi, meaning metaphorical. So every character that is attributed towards Rasulullah is also attributed towards Sayyid al-Shuhada. And just like the way Rasulullah is rahmatan lil alameen, Sayyid al-Shuhada is also rahmatan lil alameen. And one of the ways in which his mercy encompasses the hearts of the mu'mineen is through the ikama, or through the upholding of the sha'air husayniyya. Sha'air husayniyya through weeping, sha'air husayniyya through matam and latam in all its intensities, sha'air husayniyya through reciting poetry. All of these aspects are aspects of upholding and establishing the legacy of Sayyid al-Shuhada. And because you carry this heart, or this nur of wisdom in your heart, the rewards are unrestricted. Imam used to say that when the women of Bani Hashim would remember the masa'ib of Sayyid al-Shuhada, they would beat their chests and their faces out of grief for Sayyid al-Shuhada. And the Imam says, فَعَلَى مِثْلِهِ تُلْتَمَ الْخُدُودِ وَتَشُكُّ الْجُيُودِ. Your Imam says it is on the likes of Sayyid al-Shuhada that the chests and the face should be beaten for us. Hail Matam is an expression of your grief, and is a very humble expression for Sayyid al-Shuhada. One of the Maraja in Qom passed away, and his son saw him in a dream. In the night of Barzakh, he asked him, Baba, how did you find the Alam al-Barzakh? And enter, you are a marja taqleed, marja kabir, you spent your life in the service of Islam. How did you find Alam al-Barzakh? This marja tells his son, he says, the Alam of Barzakh is a kingdom, and the king in Barzakh is Sayyid al-Shuhada al-Husayn, and the currency in the kingdom of Barzakh is Azaf for Imam Husayn. This Marja Kabir tells his son, for every time we hit our hands on our chest in the dunya, we got rewarded in the Barzakh. How many times do we hit our chests in our lifetime for Sayyid al-Shuhada? Every time you stand in a halaqa and hit your chest, this is a reward for Sayyid al-Shuhada. How can a person not hit his chest or hit his face after the masa'ib that went upon Sayyid al-Shuhada? Traditions tell us, Sheikh Ja'far al-Tusti says that there were three incidences in Karbala when Sayyid al-Shuhada's ruh almost came out of his body. He says, one is when he looked at Abbas on the ground. He says, the second time Imam Hussein's ruh was going to come out of his body is when he saw Ali ibn al-Akbar. And the third time is when he was walking with Ali Asghar towards the Khaybar to give the speech back to Ramah. Ya Shia, I want to describe to you today the battle of Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas. Hi, Abu al-Fadl was the pillar of strength and the source of comfort for Sayyid al-Shuhada. But there came upon a time where there was no one within the ranks of the army of Imam فأبو الفاضل goes towards سيد الشهداء and he says to him روحي لك الفدا يا سيدي هل لي من رخصة قد ضاق صدري من هؤلاء المنافقين. سيد الشهداء goes to Imam Hussein, look at his أخلاق. He says my master يا حسين, may my mother and father be sacrificed for you, can I have permission to go into the battlefield? He says my heart cannot take the siege of the Munafiqeen anymore. Over here Rabab and Rukayya and Zainab, the women and the children are crying, the children are crying for water. Abbas says to Imam Hussein, my heart cannot bear the voices of these children. Ajib, Sayyid al-Shuhada looks at Abu al-Fadil, he puts his hands on his shoulders, he kisses him on the forehead and he says, go out and fetch water for the children. The traditions tell us Abbas went to the camp, he put the mashk, he tied the mashk around his right shoulder, he mounted his horse, he took the sword in his right hand, he took the alam in his left hand. He came out towards the tent and he looked towards Sayyid al-Shuhada for the last time. Allah, Hussein smiles at Abbas, Abbas smiles towards Hussein. This is the last time they are going to look at each other in this way. Abu al-Fadl Abbas wears his armor, he puts on his helmet, he looks at the battlefield, he says Bismillah wa billah wa fi sabilillah wa ala billati rasulillah. Abu al-Fadl rides on to the Katlaga. Between him and the Furat there are enemies. Allah, look at the words of Abu al-Fadl when he attacks into the enemies or into the enemy ranks. He recites so far woman, he says أضربكم بالصارم المحندي حتى تهيدوا عن قتال سيدي إني أنا العباس ذو التوددي نجل علي المرتدى المؤيدي. Abbas comes into the battlefield telling them that I will attack you until you move away from attacking my master Abbas. If you don't know me, I am the son of Haydar. Allah, Allah, the traditions tell us that Abu al-Fadl attack them in such a way. فيغلب الميمنة على ميسرة والميسرتهم على الميمنة. The traditions tell us that Abbas attacked the right wing, dismantling it, attacked the left wing, dismantling it. The enemies are recruiting, the enemies are retreating in every direction until they reach the Furat. As the Furat, Shimr had lined 4,000 archers. Allah, the archers' shots start shooting towards Abbas, but Abu al-Fadl had attacked them in such a way that as the army retreated, the archers got confused and all of them dispersed. The traditions tell us that the enemy state, we don't know if it was Abbas who was fighting or Haydar who had come down from the heaven. Allah, Allah, Abu al-Fadl reaches the Furat. The Furat, this water that Rukayya and Sakina have been wanting to drink for 3 days. Abbas is standing at this Furat. The traditions tell us Abu al-Fadl got down from his horse and he took a handful of this water from Furat. Ajib. Many of the khutaba say that Abu al-Fadl wanted to drink from the water and then remembered the thirst of Imam Hussein. I say this is not correct, because Abu al-Fadl Abbas's love for Hussein was much greater. How could he have even forgotten the thirst of Sakina for 1 minute? Allah, Allah, the traditions tell us he picked up the water and then he looked at the water and he recited a poem. He said, يا نفس بعد لحسين هوني وبعده لا كنت أن تكوني هذا لحسين وارد المنون وتشربين بارد المعين لا والله ما هذا من فعال ديني. Abu al-Fadl looks at the water and he says, how can I even drink this water? What benefit there is there in life after Hussein? Abbas, he says, oh nafs, how can you drink this water when Hussein is under siege? Abbas fills the water in his mashk. He rides, puts the mashk around his shoulder. He sits on his horse. He starts to move towards the Khaymaga. None of the enemies from the Kufans have the courage or the audacity to come and stand next to Abbas. They all regrouped themselves in a distance under the command of Shimmer. Shimmer said, gather the army all together in its 15,000-20,000 forge and make a wall between Abbas and between let this water net not reach the tents of Hussein, for if it reaches them, we will not be able to kill them. The Maktal tells us they line up in lines of thousands, making a wall between Abul Fadil and between the Khaymaga of Imam al-Hussein. At this time, Sayyid al-Shuhada cannot see Imam Hussein. He cannot see Abul Fadil al-Abbas. The only way he knows Abbas is safe is by looking at the alam that is wavering over the flag of Abbas. Allah, Allah. Abul Fadil takes his sword in his right hand. He has nothing in his mind except to get the water to the children. He begins to ride his horse towards the enemies. Shimmer is afraid that Abbas will get closer to the enemies, so he ordered the archers to shoot their arrows in their thousands towards Abbas. Abul Fadil defends himself from the arrows using his shield. He defends the mashk using his shield, but because of the number of arrows that were coming towards his direction, Abbas had to ride his horse a little bit slower until he passed through one of the palm trees. Behind the palm trees, there was one lion by the name Zayd ibn Arqam waiting in ambush behind the tree. As Abul Fadil rode past it, Zayd ibn Arqam, a lion came out with his sword. Allah, Allah, ya Shia! He came from behind and he struck Abul Fadil on the right arm with his sword. The arm of Abbas fell to the ground. Abul Fadil took the sword in his left hand. He took the sword between the left hand and his chest. The mashk is still there. At this time, the enemies thought if we have cut the hand of Abbas, his determination will become weaker. So they moved forward towards Abbas. At this time, Abbas said, "In kata'tumu yamini, inni uhami abadan andini, wa ana imam al-sadiq al-yakini, najlu al-nabi al-tahir al-amini." Abbas said to them, "Even if you cut my right hand, I will continue to defend the religion, and I will continue to defend the Imam, who is the grandson of Rasulullah." The Maktal tells us he did his jihad with his left hand, and he continued to fight and kill the enemies until he moved forward. The blood is gushing down from his right forearm. At this time, one of the enemies called Hakim bin Tufayl came. As Abbas was engaged in war against a number of people from his left side, Hakim came from behind, ya Shia. He lifted his sword and he struck the left arm of Abul Fadl al-Abbas. Abbas's left hand fell to the ground. Abbas took his sword fell with his hand. He took the alam. He managed it between his chest and what was remaining of his arm. He held on to the alam. His main goal is to get towards the Khaybaga. Allah, Allah. When the enemy saw that Abbas is on his horse without any arms, Shimmer told the archers, "Rain your arrows towards him." The Maktal tells us that the arrows fell on Abbas as if there were rain. There were hundreds of arrows that Abbas faced with his chest. But I want to tell you about two arrows. Allah, Allah, from these hundred, there was one arrow that was shot that pierced the left eye of Abul Fadl. The left eye is pierced with an arrow. Abul Fadl Abbas is bleeding from his face. He cannot see properly. And the second arrow came. Ya Shia, this arrow pierced the mashk of Abul Fadl. Allah, Allah. I don't know what went through the heart of Abul Fadl Abbas when he saw the water pouring down from the mashk. But the Maktal tells us that this time Abbas stopped riding his horse. He didn't know, should he go forward to the tent or should he go back to the Furat? If he goes to the Furat, how will he fill the mashk? He doesn't have hands. At this time, as Abbas was thinking what to do, the Maktal tells us, فَإِذَا إِلَيْهِ اللَّعِينَ وَدَرَبَهُ بِالْعَمُودِيَ الْأَرَاسِ. The Maktal tells us a lion came with a tent pole.
پردے کا درد ہو گیا ہے. Abdul Fadil fell down from his horse, the Maktab tells us. Wafalaka Ahmadahu. He split the skull of Abdul Fadil Abbas open. As Abbas fell to the ground, he said, Mawlaya ya Aba Abdullah, alayka minnis salam. The Maktab tells us when Sayyidah Shuhada heard this, he went running towards Imam Hussein. But for every two steps Imam Hussein would take, he would fall down. And then he would stand up. He would run another two steps, and then Imam Hussein would fall down. Imam Hidi bin Muslim says, I went closer, and I heard Imam Hussein say, Al-Arif Qasar al-Ahri. He said, Abbas, my back is broken. I cannot run towards you. Hamid ibn Muslim says, I kept following Hussein until he got closer to Abul Fadl al-Abbas, and at one time I saw Sayyid al-Shuhada fall down to the ground. He picked something up, he put it on his forehead and he kissed it. Hamid ibn Muslim says, I went closer to see what is it that Hussein has found on the battleground. Ya Shia, put your hands on your heart. This is Hussein who found the cut out arm of Abbas on the battleground. He picked it and put it on his forehead and he kissed it. He kept walking towards Abu Fadl al-Abbas. He saw him lying on the ground with no hands, with an arrow on his, with an arrow planted in his eye. I will not tell you what Abbas talked with Hussein, but let me tell you what the Maktal tells us, huh? The Maktal tells us, فَنَّذَرَ إِلَيْهِ الْحُسَيْنِ. Hussein looks at Abul Fadl al-Abbas, Ya Shia, put your hands on your heart. The Maktal tells us, وَمُخُّهُ سَائِلٌ عَلَى كَتَفَيْنِ.